Hello, today we're solving a Google coding interview question related to string manipulation. It's called longest string chain. We are given some strings, here is example on the left, and we need to choose some of them and reorder them into a sequence or a chain. Here it will be optimal to do that in order 1, 2, 3, 4, so that every next word in a chain could be created by taking the previous word or string and adding one letter wherever you want. For example, BCA can follow BA because we insert C here right in the middle. It is allowed to add a letter anywhere, including the beginning and the end of a word. In particular, BA could be then transformed to DBA or, for example, BAW, a lot of words, but of course they must exist in the input and those two do not. There is no DBA here. The order of character matters. It isn't enough that BDA is there, so we could use this one. For input on the left, the answer is 4, because this is longest chain you can create. Obviously, if there is no string of length 5, then you cannot go longer than 4, because every next string will be longer by 1. If I change a single letter, like here from B instead of E, then now we cannot create something of length 4, and I think even 3 is impossible. Now the longest chain would be 2. Regarding the constraints, let's assume that strings are quite short, so the length of every string, L, is limited by, I think in LeetCode problem it is 16, later I will implement a solution and submit it. There is also alphabet size, and you can say it's constant if we are allowed, let's say, lowercase English letters, because then A is 26, I will say up to 26. But theoretically then an interviewer could follow up with, what if those characters could be anything in ASCII code? What if there are 256 possibilities? Or what if those are not strings, but sequences of numbers, and then alphabet becomes huge? So it's good to keep A in mind, alphabet size, when we talk about complexity. Finally, for N, we can talk about easier version with N up to 1000, but we will also talk about N around, let's say, 100,000, 10 to 5. Because this is also possible to solve. By the way, if you're preparing for your coding interviews, I recommend platform algoexpert.io. They have almost 100 problems with detailed explanation and code walkthrough. Plus, there is now a sale on their new system design section. Use code ERIHTA for additional discount. Back to longest string chain problem. When can we move from one string to the other? We can do it here because we can insert character D between CA, then we have BCDA, exactly what we wanted to get. ERIHTA from the future here. There is one easy way to do that. If you greedily go from the left for both strings and you take as long common prefix as possible, here it would be BC and then also BC, then you say the next character, that one doesn't match, it must be added in the first string, so here we add D. And then the remaining part, the suffix, needs to be the same. This would be O of L. You just linearly go through both strings. But this cannot possibly be improved, so we wouldn't need to iterate through all n square pairs of strings. And this is why I'm going to explore other possibilities, how we can say that two strings match each other. And from one of those possibilities, we'll get a nice solution at the end without n square factor. We can iterate over position where to insert a new character, or alternatively, over position of the last character we want to keep, and then after that there will be a new one, because it's hard to iterate over something that will be in the middle of two positions. If I index this string 0, 1, 2, then what is this position? Is it 0.5? No, it's not. So instead, I would say that this position, the first for loop, will be the last character in the left part. Then I will even say this will be from minus 1 to length minus 1. So not between. I iterate over the last character to keep, this or that. Let's think what this position means. It means that I want this will be left part of the string, the right part. And here in between, I'm inserting new character. I need to iterate over that. This is second for loop. I iterate over position from minus 1 to L minus 1, over new character from A to Z, and S will be new combined string. First part, possibly empty if position is minus 1, plus new character, plus everything from position plus 1 to the end of a string. Let's say that here uppercase A denotes the left string. This is A, I want to get this B. So I will here compare if S is equal to uppercase B. If yes, then I know I can get from string A to string B. What about the complexity though? It is O of first for loop is over every position in the first string, the length we set is uppercase L, times the second for loop inside, it's nested so we multiply, it's over alphabet size, and then here we concatenate and compare two strings. Each of those two actions is linear of the size of a string, so times additional L. This is O of A times L squared. If we look at these constraints again, O of A times L square, it doesn't look that bad, but for sure we cannot multiply it by N square. If you're going to, for every pair of strings, check if from one you can get to the other, this is too much already, because N square is around 1 million, and multiply it by even small numbers to first times this one square, it is too much. It isn't always easiest or fastest to just apply what is written in the statement. They say from one string you can get to the other if you can insert a character at any position. In many problems it's easier to analyze the process backwards. What if we can remove a character? Instead of adding a character in BCA, I will say I'm looking at string B, BCDA, and I want to remove one character here and check if this way I'm getting string A. If I iterate over characters, and in particular I will consider removing D, I see that what remains is BCA, and this is equal to A. Thanks to this observation, thanks to the fact that we analyze the process backwards, we don't need to iterate over a character. Instead, we just iterate over position and concatenate left part and right part. The new version is both simpler and faster, because in string B, the longer one, we iterate a position, and we check if everything in that string up to position minus 1 plus everything from position plus 1 to the end, because the character at position is removed, we check if that concatenated, if it gives us the shorter string A. Then we have a match. This time the complexity is L for iterating over position here with a for loop, and another L for concatenating and for comparing two strings. Remember that here for loop is nested with, for example, concatenation, but those two are not nested. You first do around L operations here, then another L operations here. In total, it's 2L, not L square. But it's multiplied by for loop, so this is O of L square, slightly better than our previous solution. We already could solve a problem, count the number of pairs, such that from one you can directly get the other, but from this it's still far away to solving the full problem of finding the longest chain. First, it will help us to imagine that everything is a graph. A string is a vertex, and if you can get from one string to the other, like from A directly to BA by inserting a character, then there is an edge. Of course, you can think about the reverse thing, from BA you get A, but it doesn't matter that much. The drawing will look the same, it's just that arrows will be in different directions. Any chain like this one in original graph, where from shorter you get to longer string, it corresponds to a chain in reversed graph. The answer doesn't change. So I can draw whatever order I want the arrows to be, just let's be consistent. This is graph corresponding to the sample input, the one from the first slide. You can also notice that on the left this time I sorted strings by length. It helps me because I know now that from string of length S I will get only two strings of length S plus 1. Well, uppercase L, remember, was a limit for length of a string. So I could theoretically group everything into different lengths and then only investigate pairs from one group to the next group. I know that from B I will not get directly to BCA by inserting a single character. And this is how I drew a graph. I first wrote on the left A and B. I knew that from them there could be edges to BA, from BA to something of length 3, and so on. This test isn't really interesting because from every string of length S, there is edge to every string of length S plus 1. So let's make it more interesting. I added two more strings, one of length 5 and one of length 2. To BC we can get from B by inserting C, but there is no edge from A to BC. From BC we cannot get to BDA, but we can to BCA by inserting A at the end. And BDAC, it is impossible to get from one to the other. Remember, the order of characters matters. You cannot here reorder CA into AC. From AC it would be possible. Also, those two strings, they look promising. You can insert two times character C at the end, but we want a chain, a full chain. After every string, if we insert something new, this string should be in the input. This is a new graph, and again, the longest chain is of size 4. For example, A, B, A, B, D, A, B, D, C, A. This is chain with 4 strings. In particular, we can go B, B, C, B, C, A, B, D, C, A. It doesn't matter, we need just the longest. We don't need to count them or something. Nobody knows a polynomial algorithm to find the longest path in just any graph. If the problem says you're given a graph, find the longest path or the length of a longest path without repetitions or something like that, because if there are cycles, then the length is infinity. This is so-called NP-hard problem. You could then say to your interviewer that nobody knows how to do it. But this is not just any graph. This is directed acyclic graph, or in short, DAG, a DAG. Edges are directed, and acyclic means there are no cycles. Why are there no cycles? Because every time an edge goes from string of some length to longer one. So there cannot be a cycle, because that would mean an edge back to something shorter. But we know that we always move from one group to the next one, to the next one, to the next one, and so on. Every path follows only to the right. There can be no cycles. And fortunately for us, in DAGs, it is possible to find the longest path with something similar to dynamic programming. It's quite easy if you can sort vertices of a graph in such an order that edges only go to the right. And here it's easy because we sort strings by length. Then for every string from the rightmost one, so from longest, or for any vertex, you say, starting from here, what is the longest path? Well, it just contains this single vertex, so it's one. There are no edges connected to this vertex, but still it's a vertex of a graph. For this guy, still the longest path is 1. And now for this one, we consider all the edges going out of BCA. In particular, there is this one to BDCA. We know that from here, even if there is something more to the right, we don't need to explore it, because this number tells us what is the longest path from DCA. And we say, okay, if from here I have a path of length 1, then here I have a path of length 2. If this number was instead 4, I would here say, okay, 5 is possible. Now what if here there was 4, which means a path starting from here to the right of length 4, and there is here some other word with length 7. Not length of word 7, length of path to the right. Then BCA would know that the longest path starting here is 8. We take maximum out of strings of vertices to which there are edges from me, plus 1 for myself. But in our example, this is 1, this is 2, this is also 2, and actually here it's quite trivial, 3, 3, 4, 4. This way, for every vertex, you will count the longest path starting here, and you just need to print the maximum out of those numbers. It is possible that this maximum will not occur in the first group on the left, because maybe there are no edges like this, because maybe this is not A and B, but this is W and Z, something not appearing in any other word. Then this would be just 1, 1, and here a 3 would be maximum. But as we go through vertices, and for every vertex we compute its score, we take the maximum of all of those. It even turns out that we don't have to sort by length. We can have a recursive function, like in any dynamic programming with memoization, and when we run function longest, give me the longest path starting from vertex V, let's say that this vertex V is this one, representing string BA, we don't necessarily have to already have computed all other longer strings, we will just hear ask longest of vertices to which there are edges from me. So I will ask what is longest starting at BCA, and maybe this value is not already computed. Maybe it is. If this is already computed as 2, cool. Then now I'm updating my own score as possible 3. But if it's not, it's still not defined, then we just run longest of BCA. And for BCA, it will compute something using values on the right, and eventually it will be computed as 2, and it will return its value here. In a moment, we will see that in detail in my code. And as in any recursion with memoization, here obviously we need to say, if this value is already computed, then return this value, don't go again through all the graph on the right, because then the complexity would be worse. Final improvement before we move to implementation. Can we avoid iterating over all n square pairs of strings in order to check if there is an edge, if we can get from this string to that one? We had already some improvement that we can only get from string of length s to s plus 1, but maybe half of all strings in the input have length 10, the other half they have length 11, and then anyway the number of pairs is around n square, maybe n square over 4. It will be n half times n half. That's bad. And you need to multiply that by the complexity to check a single pair of strings, so it will be n square times our l square. We talked about that part already. And later we will use those edges to our DFS-like dynamic programming with recursion. What if we can just iterate over a single string? We want complexity O of n times something, not O of n square. If I just look at BCA, can I do something with this without iterating over the other string in a pair? Our algorithm to compare two strings was about iterating over one string and removing every character. Let's just do that for this single string. Let's consider removing B, then what is left is CA, and I can check with some dictionary, map, set, hash set, if this string exists in the input, and if yes, then what is its index? Here CA doesn't exist, but if instead I remove C and concatenate the left and right part, I get from this BA, let's say strings are indexed 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I should know from some dictionary that BA has index 4. And then I say there is edge between 3 and 4. Actually, I iterated over something in longer string. I will say there is edge from 4 to 3 in my graph, and graph I will create has indices from 0 to n minus 1, those things on the left. Some other time when I iterate over characters of BDCA, in particular I consider removing D, and by after concatenating the left and right part I have BCA, I know from some dictionary that it is here with index 3, so I know that there should be edge between 3 and 5. 5 was the string where I iterated over character to erase, so it's longer one. There is edge from 3 to 5. This is already in combination chain of length 4, 3 and 5, so length 3. But well, we will use our recursion with memoization to find that length of the longest chain. This problem can be found on LeetCode. In particular, there is this sample test. Limits are n up to 1000, length L is up to 16, and alphabet size is English lowercase letters, so 26. After I'm done implementing, I will take again a look at the whole code to analyze the complexity. In C++, complexity-wise, unordered map is the best for our needs, to remember for every string what is its position, his position, let's say. I need n for my convenience. N will be the number of words. For every index from 0 to n minus 1, his position of words of I is I. Now I'm able to quickly say for the string where it is in the input, if it is there. Iterate over a string. And now, for convenience, let's create a variable for the string, it will be s. Every character, consider removing it and concatenate the two parts. In C++, there is, I think, function substr, and it takes the first position, 0, and the length, j. Let's think if j will work. I want to say remove s of j. The last character before that was j minus 1. From 0 to j minus 1, there are j characters. Or, for example, if j is, say, 2, this will be start from 0 and take 2 characters. So it will take characters 0 and 1. Cool. This plus concatenates as starting from j plus 1 till the end. I don't think that here we need anything. By default, it takes till the end. So this is up, maybe. This will be string s without a single character. We can find iterator where this string is in his position, hash map. If it's not found, then this iterator points to the end of a map, position end, then continue. There is not such, there is no such word. For example, for BDCA, we consider removing, let's say, D for j equal to 2. It would be BCA. Then this BCA would be string maybe. Otherwise, edges of IT second is this index. First is a string itself. To this, we push back I. I is index of this longer string. So there is now edge from shorter to longer. I could do it the other way around. I already explained that chain to the right is the same length as chain to the left. Edges would be, for every vertex, a list or vector of adjacency. This is two-dimensional thing, edges. And here, edges clear, edges resize. I said that answer will be maximum over multiple over score for every vertex, score meaning the length of chain starting here, for every vertex. Now I will use the fact how easy it is to iterate over just numbers, because if vertices are numbered from 0 to n minus 1, this is how easy you iterate over them. Also, you can just use vector instead of slower maps or hash maps. This is faster way to store edges rather than have some map from string to a list of other strings. Because there are some hashes involved, or if you used not an ordered map, there will be extra logarithm. It's faster to first handle kind of compression from strings into just numbers, and now we have a standard graph problem. Consider answer to be longest of I, and I need to implement this recursive longest function. It will use memoization. Score of, here again, I will say, I'm not sure if I need to clear. This is a case if there can be multiple tests and the same class will be run. Maybe clear is not necessary, but I'm not sure, so I will clear anyway. Resize doesn't clear, by the way. Score resize n, and let's say I will fill this with minus ones or just with zeros. This thing, it sets everything to zero. Now, zero will mean that this value is not set. If something is calculated, it will be positive for sure. If score of v is already not zero, then return score of v, not to repeat stuff. And now here, for every vertex, I will only once be computing its score, gradient, compute the score. But I need to iterate over, let's say, b in edges of v. B is vertex to which I get, score of V is maximum of itself. Now, it isn't correct to say score of B plus 1, because score of B might be not calculated. In recursion, you need to use longest of B. All of that, by the way, can be done iteratively as well, but then you would need to sort strings by length, and or in general, do a topological sort, which is harder and unnecessary here. I believe I'm done. But I'm not done. I outputted 3 instead of 4. I can either read my whole code, or maybe easier here print longest of I, maybe it will help me in any way, and to run code again. In printed values, I see 0. 0 shouldn't be here. Those are indices of things in the input. So for A, the longest path found was 3, then 3, 2, and so on. For BDCA, it is 0. But as length, I'm counting, I should count this vertex itself as well, because this is number of strings in a chain. So even if something doesn't have any edges out, I should say this is already 1. Even if there will be not a single edge, and then if there is some edge, then I consider its length from that forward plus 1. Now I believe I will get a 4. Let's remove here C out, because even though in LeetCode you can submit with C out, it takes time to print. You might get time limit exceeded. It happens from time to time. This is correct, and as you see here, quite fast, because it's good to change strings into ints, plus I don't iterate over all the pairs of strings. Once you have code, it's easier to analyze the complexity. There are several parts here. The first is to create this map. For every string in the input, you insert it in hashmap. Hashmap has constant expected time, so that's cool. There are n elements and n strings, and each of them, let's say, has length up to l. This part would be then O of n times L, or just O of input size, because input size is like the sum of lengths of strings. You cannot do in such a problem better than this for sure. Here we have n times iterating over character inside L, times here concatenating two parts. This is another L, three things nested in each other. This is O of n times L square already, but we said that even comparing two strings would be L square. We talked about two ways to do that. Times here n, because we iterate over single string. What we do is we don't care about the shorter string yet. In our check to compare two strings, we focus on the longer one. Fortunately, we don't have n square here. It's just n. At the end, we have longest run on each vertex. But what is important here is for every vertex, only once you will really try to compute its score, otherwise it's memorized already. So here, once you iterate over edges going out of this, and pessimistically there will be edges to everything else. Like if there in the input there are a lot of pairs of strings that you can get from one to the other directly. So for each of n vertices, there are n edges at most, n square. And the total complexity is the sum of everything here. This is total complexity spent on this part for all the vertices. For each of n vertices, only once you will do this code. Hence, n times n. If you sum up those complexities, n square, n times l, and nl square, you will get the total thing. The total thing will be, well, nl is only smaller than this, so I will just say the complexity is n times l square times n square. And we don't have alphabet in the complexity. This means we wouldn't be hurt at all running time wise if the input could have much more characters, many more characters, or just it would be sequences of ints, where from one sequence you can get to the other by inserting any number anywhere. Oh, sorry, this is not times, this is obviously plus. You might remember though that I said we are good even for n up to 100,000. And for n up to 100,000, n square element is too bad. Actually, this cannot be n square. In fact, this is m, O of m, the number of total edges in a graph. And this is limited in some way. It is limited by that part of our code where we create those edges. We create all the edges here. The total number of edges can be only, at most, n times l. Because this is at most how many times we insert a single new edge. And this is why amortized complexity for this part is only O of m, where this is n times l, and actually here we have n times l. So the total complexity is nl squared. Quite nice. Thanks for watching. Go check out algoexpert.io if you want more organized coding interview preparation. Bye!